Hey everyone, it's Justin again. In the last video, we learned how to solve basic quadratic equations by completing the square. But there are lots of different quadratic equations, ones with only one solution or no solutions at all, or ones that have a leading coefficient, or ones that don't even have a middle term. The list goes on and on. So in this video, you'll learn how completing the square can be used to solve these more advanced types of quadratic equations. By the end of this lesson, you will be able to solve more advanced quadratic equations by completing the square. We'll break down the features that make the equations harder to solve, starting with equations that have different amounts of solutions and how to recognize them, then equations that have leading coefficients, and finally, equations that are missing the middle term entirely. First, let's look at some examples with different numbers of solutions. We start off like normal by moving all constants to the right side. Half of 12 is 6, and the square of that is 36, so we add 36 on both sides. Now that the square on the left side has been completed, we can factor it into x plus 6 squared, and negative 36 plus 36 is 0. Right here is how we can tell how many solutions there are. If we cancel the square with a square root, the square root of 0 is just 0. No positive, no negative, just 0. So when we solve, we don't have to split it because there's only one solution, negative 6. In the last video, we only saw positive values on the right side after completing the square, and there were always two solutions. And we just saw that if you complete the square and the right side is 0, there will only be one solution. Completing the square is actually kind of similar to the discriminant. The final possibility, completing the square with a negative number on the right side, means there will be no solutions because you can't take the square root of a negative. In the last lesson, none of the examples had a leading coefficient, but lots of quadratic equations do. In order to complete the square, move any constants to the right side. Usually, at this step, we need to take half of the middle term and square it. But that doesn't work if there's a leading coefficient. So what do? Divide it off, of course. 4 divided by 4 is 1, 2 divided by 4 is 1 half, and 3 divided by 4 is 3 fourths. Now there's no longer a leading coefficient, and we can complete the square. This is where leading coefficients get kind of messy. Lots of fractions. Half of a half is 1/4, and the square of that is 1/16. We'll need to simplify that right side by getting a common denominator. 4 times 4 is 16, the same as the other fraction, and if we also multiply the top by 4, we get 12. 12/16 plus 1/16 is 13/16. Whew. So we can factor the completed square, x plus 1/4 squared, because that's the value we squared to get 1/16, and the right side is 13/16. Cancel the square with a square root, and since 16 is a perfect square, we can simplify it to just 4. Now we subtract 1/4 from both sides, and now x is by itself. We're almost done. We just need to combine these fractions together. Since the denominators match, we could just combine the numerators. And finally, we're done. The solutions are negative 1 plus the square root of 13 divided by 4, and negative 1 minus the square root of 13 divided by 4. Ugh, that's a mouthful. This is why completing the square is so hard with leading coefficients. You end up with a whole mess of fractions. Sometimes completing the square can make solving a quadratic nice and simple, but that last example proved that it wasn't always the case. All the trouble with fractions started because of that leading coefficient. So, as a rule of thumb, any time there's a leading coefficient, you're better off using the quadratic formula. 2 squared is 4, negative 4 times 4 times negative 3 is positive 48, and 2 times 4 is 8. 4 plus 48 is 52, which is 4 times 13. So we can pull out the square root of 4, which is 2. The denominator and both terms in the numerator are all divisible by 2, so we can reduce them all. And now, we got the same answer as before with a fraction of the effort. Yeah? See what I did there? Fraction of the... Okay, anyway. There's a reason why there are multiple methods to solve quadratics. If one method doesn't seem to be working out, just try a different one. That last example was a doozy, so let's finish this lesson with an easier problem. This quadratic equation is missing a middle term completely, but the first step is still the same. Add 11 to get the constant off the left side. And we learned from the last example that if there's a leading coefficient, we should divide that off too. And guess what? The left side is already a completed square. It's x squared. Take the square root of both sides, and the square root of 4 is positive or negative 2. When there's no middle term, completing the square happens automatically without you having to do the whole split and square thing. Sure, you can choose to do it. Just give the middle term a coefficient of 0. Half of 0 is 0, and 0 squared is 0. Now we factor it into x plus 0 squared. Use a square root to cancel the square and subtract 0 from both sides. But subtracting 0 doesn't do anything, so we can take it off. See? Same answer as before. We didn't have to try to complete the square because the square was already complete without a middle term. There are a lot of different quadratic equations out there, and you've now got the tools to solve all of them. In the next lesson, we'll return to graphing and see how all of these methods for solving quadratic equations can also be used to graph quadratic functions in standard form. See you then!